So good morning, everyone. You should be interactive for the questions asked, right? So we are back to the class on smart materials and structures towards the end of our module one. So if you remember, we dealt about something related to the motion across the axial rods, right? So axial motion of the rods with mechanical loading condition we dealt about. And also we dealt about the actuator loading condition, means to say for direct and the indirect piezoelectric effect. We delivered the equation for the stress as well as the strain, including for the structures associated with the piezoelectric patches. So we dealt in case of mechanical loading, what happens is you will be applying the force and voltage will be zero. Then we derive the equation. Similarly, for actuator loading, what happens is you will apply the voltage, which will be greater than zero, and force, what you apply, will be zero because you are focusing on indirect piezoelectric effect. So, what are the stress and strain distribution? So, that we dealt about in the last class. And also, we dealt when both the mechanical and the velocity loading comes together, what will be the equation? So, it is nothing but the combination of the stress, what we delivered for mechanical loading, and the combination of the stress for the actuator loading. So that gives rise to the stress distribution when you have the mechanical as well as the piezoelectric loading for a given specimen. So these were the three conditions what we dealt about. And then we also studied how to do a mathematical model for a uniform strain model. So what will be the total force, which will be the combination of the force expressed at the actuator or the piezo element plus the substrate. And we derived an equation, equilibrium equation with respect to the strain. So we related that to our free strain for a particular cross-sectional area. Then we showed that at equilibrium condition, the strain across the actuator and the strain across the substrate will be the same. And we spoke something related to the stiffness ratio, which will depend upon the elastic modulus of the structure to that of the piezo element related to the cross-sectional area of the specimen in which the piezo patch has been applied. So this also we dealt about. And suppose if bending comes into picture, how the relation changes. So this also we dealt. Finally, the induced strain to the actuation strain ratio will be in this way. There is no derivation for this. You should be only knowing the formula for the relationship. So we ended up with this part. So now you know how to derive the equation for the rod. If they give you a rod, right? So axial motion across the rod due to the piezo patches for direct and indirect piezo effect, you know. And also you know how to derive an equation for uniform strain model. So next, what you have at the end of your syllabus is related to bending of beams. Until now, you have studied the axial motion across the rod. Rod is nothing but the structure. But when actual bending takes place, how you will relate these equations of stress and strain? For this, we have focused on the Bernoulli's beam model equation. So what do you mean exactly by an Euler-Bernoulli beam model? So it will be subjected with respect to beam point of view. So before going in depth, you should understand the geometry of the beam with respect to the PZT actuator. So here you can see this is called as the beam. The geometry of the beam is nothing but our structure or the substrate. So above this structure, you will be having the patch of piezo element above as well as the below. So half portion of the structure will be referred to be as H. And here the thickness of the actuator is defined by the word T suffix A. So this is how you have to deal with respect to the concept of PZT actuator. So now before going to the thing, the two concepts you have to understand related to the bending of the beams. So what are these two concepts? Here you can see that the system what you will consider for the bending of beam will be similar to that of the concept of the rod what you use. But only thing, there we didn't focus about the beam, but here we will be focusing upon the concept of the beam. For that, the two main important differences what you have to understand are as mentioned here. Firstly, you will be having the PZT actuator, which will be bonded equally at the top as well as the bottom surface. In case of rod, what used to have happen is, used to have a small patch of PZT, as we have seen here in the previous slides. See, you will be having a PZT patch only across a particular area of cross section. But here, when it comes for the beam modeling, Euler beam modeling concept, you will be having the uniform length of the PZT patch as shown in the diagram. So this is one of the differences. Such that why it has been placed in that way, because the structures are driven by the voltage of opposite polarity. You will be having a, if you have positive terminal of voltage here, here you'll be having the negative terminal. Again, you'll be having the positive terminal of voltage here and the negative terminal. Why? I have told you PZT are dielectric material. To make it conductive, you should apply a silver paste at the top and bottom of the PZT element. Similarly, here at the top and bottom of the PZT element. And this electrode will be parallel across the surface of the structure. And hence, you will be having the polarity variations in opposite direction. So that is what being told. So this type of arrangement will help the piezo element to expand and contract when you apply the voltage or the mechanical load to it. Okay. So this is about the concept of why the PZT patch is applied at the top and bottom with the opposite polarity. When it is subjected to bending, it has to expand and contract. Both is needed. So for that, you should see that the polarity of the voltage what you apply will be in the opposite sign convention. If you apply same polarity, then it won't help to get the required expansion or the contraction. It can only expand or it can only contract. But if you need both of it, a proper polarity establishment is necessary. Accordingly, you should subject the voltage terminals across the top and the bottom PZT patch. And due to this expansion and contraction, this expansion and contraction you get depending upon whether you are applying the direct piezo effect or the indirect piezo effect. Irrespective of the both, you will get one expansion and one get contraction. So due to this moment of expansion and the contraction, you will get the resulting deformation in the base structure. So you will get the deformation in the base structure is nothing but this part. So you will get the deformation in the base structure as well as in the piezo patch. So the deformation what we get in the base structure is modeled in our bending model. Okay. So the beam and the piezoelectric actuators, how it looks is shown in the next slide. I have shown you the diagram already. Please be careful. You have to understand each and every step. So to develop a beam model, a person by Euler derived the equation for the beam model of the base structure along with the actuator or the piezo element. And hence it is termed to be as Euler-Bernoulli beam model. And it is adopted. This beam model is well established very long before. And this model is adopted or accepted with respect to a particular assumption. What is that assumption is the transverse plane section remains plane during deformation and stress varies linearly through the thickness of the beam. I told you when you apply, suppose if this is an actuator element, what you are applying, obviously you won't go for the direct piezo element. You will subject a mechanical loading to it. So when you subject a mechanical loading to the piezo element across the structure of the beam, you will get a particular deformation. Why you get the particular deformation? Because some stress is generated within the given piezo element as well as the structure. But what concept they have adopted to derive this equation is the stress what you get is linearly varying with respect to the thickness of the beam. So it shows what is the thickness of the beam actually you are using. So based on the thickness of the beam, you will get the respective stress value. So that is the assumption which has been followed in deriving Euler-Bernoulli beam model. So one more assumption is the transverse plane section remains plane during the deformation. So when it deforms, the body can expand or contract. So this expansion or the contraction takes place across the transverse plane. Suppose if you are subjecting the load in this direction, obviously the body has to deform. It has to expand in X direction or else it has to contract in the X direction only towards your left. So this direction will be nothing but our transverse plane. So what has been told is the transverse plane always remains plane during the deformation. Means to say that the transverse plane will be along the direction of the force what you have applied. That means to say both the planes are mapping along the same line where you get the deformation. So this is the two concepts what the Euler adopted to derive the equation. So this gets acceptable in all cases, only excluding the discontinuities that may arise due to piezoelectric free strain. So this will be applicable theoretically and experimentally for any piezo element you are using. Suppose if any discontinuity come across due to some piezoelectric free strain, at that case you cannot adopt this concept of assumption. So this is one exclusive thing which has been considered. Suppose you do it for lead-based piezo element, it will work on properly. And now we are synthesizing new lead-free piezoelectric element. In this case, what happens is you might get sudden free strain, a large amount at the room temperature. So when it goes for high temperature application, the free strain can vary. So there will be no consistency in it. So due to variation in the consistency, you will get a discontinuity here. So due to this discontinuity, the concept of the stress varying linearly to the thickness of the beam might not be followed because due to some disruption or the barrier which results due to piezoelectric free strain. So this is the basic funda of the concept which has been assumed or adapted in Euler-Bernoulli beam model. Is this concept clear? Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, please understand carefully. So based on this, next what you have to understand is, suppose if the given beam and the actuators were bent by an external load. So this happens when you are using an actuator. So bending is now coming across the actuator because you are subjecting some external load. So external load is nothing but the mechanical load. Okay. So if you have an external load applied into an upward curvature, so you'll be having the top and the bottom piezo patch. If the external load is applied only to the curvature, upward curvature, so you will be having the top curvature as well as the bottom curvature. If only the mechanical loading is applied across the surface, upward curvature, what happens is the portion of the beam above the neutral axis and the top piezo element would be placed in compression. So what is called the portion of the beam above the neutral axis. Here you can see a line. So this line is nothing but our neutral axis. If only the load is applied to the top curvature, the upper part of the piezo element and the half portion of the beam above the neutral axis will be having the behavior of compression. So this is one concept you have to understand. So when you have this case of compression only across the top part of the beam with the piezo patch, what will happen to the bottom part of the beam along with the piezo patch? So it results in tension. So the bottom half of the structure will remain in the tension. So due to this tension, again corresponding strain and the stress distribution will occur in the bottom structure. So that can be observed in the diagram 2.11 and 2.12. So here you can see, so this is the diagram for the strain distribution for the external loading. Okay, so here what you can see is the top one is the shaded part slightly above is the actuator, the top patch of the actuator and the bottom patch of the actuator. And the between layer from here till here is half part of the beam above the neutral axis. And this is the half part of the beam or the base structure below the neutral axis. So here, this is how the stress. So the strain is referred here across our x-axis. Okay. So the strain distribution, you can see how it varies in the base structure as well as in the PZT element. So here the strain will be more in comparison to the base structure. So the base structure, which is near to the piezo element, means the bottom surface of the base structure, which is across the piezo element, will be having more strain. Whereas the part of the structure, which is away from the piezo element, will not be having that much amount of strain. Across the intersection, along the neutral axis, it is totally zero. So as the base structure comes towards the piezo element, you have some amount of the strain. So the bottom structure of the base, which is adhering to the piezo element, will be having equal value of the strain with respect to the piezo patch. But whereas the strain distribution will be comparatively more with respect to the base structure. Similarly, here at the top of the neutral axis, which have the compression. So bottom will be having the tension part and top will be having the compression part. Even due to compression, you can observe the strain. So the strain value in the piezo patch due to compression will be in the negative value, right? Even though it is in negative value at the top surface of the base structure. So the top from the neutral axis, this is the upper part of the beam. So from the neutral axis, this is the lower part of the beam. So as the beam is coming away from the PZT patch, you can see the strain is reducing and it is in negative value. But whereas the negative value strain, even though it is negative value across the piezo patch, the strain will be more. So this is about the strain distribution. So next, coming to the stress distribution, okay, with respect to the external loading. So what's happening here? So we observed the strain distribution. Now you can see the stress distribution. So the stress distribution is also similar to that of the concept what we explained. So here the stress will be taken along the x-axis and the strain will be taken along, the stress will be taken along the x-axis. And the deformation you get with respect to the direction in which the polarization has been taken place. So no need to focus more on the polarization concept. The graph is mainly speaking about your the stress distribution, which is along your positive x direction. So here also you can see the stress resulting due to the applied mechanical loading is more in the PZT patch at the bottom as well as the top. So the stress, whereas the stress resulting in the base structure is not exactly equal to the PZT patch. You can say it is nearly to 50 to 60% of the actual stress which has been resulting in the PZT patch. And that starts degrading and results to the value of zero across our neutral axis. Similarly, this is your our top base structure. So above the top base structure, you have the PZT patch in it. So this PZT patch is also having high strain results in comparison to the base structure. not fully equal. In case of the strain value in the PZT patch as well as the structure was almost equal across the top and the bottom of the structure. But whereas here, the stress what you're getting is not equal. It is almost 50 to 60% of that of the base structure. That shows that more stress is generated in the piezo element or the piezo patch what you are using when it is subjected to mechanical loading. So this is the comparison in between the stress and the strain which results in the beam across the PZT patch. So this you should be able to explain while drawing the diagram. So this is, you should be very clear in each step. Each step, first we understood the concept of bending across the beam, how Euler-Bernoulli beam model was developed with respect to what assumptions, and how the given geometry of the beam looks like with respect to PZT actuators and the terminologies of H and T suffix A. So H is half portion of the beam structure and T suffix A is the thickness of the PZT patch what you are using. So both the thickness will be the same. So that we understood. And then after understanding the strain and stress distribution with respect to external loading, further we have to know about the free strain concept. Okay, so what's happening here? So it is in continuity, there is no disturbance in between. So now before going, you have to study this slide. Then only you'll get the connectivity. Yes, so we referred the bottom half of the structure will be in tension and corresponding strain and stress distributions we explained in the figure. And then what you have to understand now is the strain which is being developed will be continuous at the beam actuator interface. I showed you by the diagram. It will be continuous across the beam structure, the strain. But the stress is discontinuous because I told you that you won't be having an equal stress distribution across the PZT patch and the structure. What is the reason? The reason is you have the difference in the Young's modulus of the substrate as well as the actuator. Due to the variation in these two values, you cannot yield up with the same amount of stress because the Young's modulus of the substrate will be different and the Young's modulus of the PZT will be different. Due to this variation across the interface of the structure with the piezo element, you will be having the variation in the Young's modulus. Due to the variation in the Young's modulus, the value of the stress distribution will not be mapping equal. So this is the next thing what you have to understand. And next, it will be necessary to identify always a quantity or value which occurs at the interface. So due to this variation, you should know why or what is the value which occurs exactly at the interface of the structure with that of the piezo element. For that, you should know the difference of the value of the H. I told you the value of the H is equal to the distance from the neutral axis to the upper part of the substrate or the lower part of the substrate, which is called as H. So that variation with respect to the interface will be now onwards referred by the subscript letter H. So H will be nothing but the distance from the neutral axis to the top surface of the beam. Why it is considered? Because the structure is symmetric about its midplane. Symmetric means it is equal exactly, either whether you take the upper part or the lower part of the structure. See, it is equal exactly. Above the neutral axis is also equal and below the neutral axis is also equal, due to the symmetry of the beam what you are taking with respect to the neutral axis. And if you want to get the value of the midplane, what do you mean by midplane? So this is the upper part. If you need the value across the midplane, means you have to write one more line which is exactly half of the upper part. So that is nothing but the midplane. So if you need the value of the midplane, then that will be equal to half the value of H. So you will be telling H is equal to T suffix S by 2. So that is the thickness of the substrate divided by 2. What does it show? So this is the entire thickness of the upper surface of the substrate, which is TS. So if you need across the mid plane, then it will be equal to TS by 2. So that is what being shown here. Okay. So now based on the substrate thickness, you have to know the value of the mechanical loading. So this week, now you hope you understand the mid plane. What do you mean by it? What will be the value of mid plane? So now we have to come back to the beam actuator free strain. All of these are continuity one after the other. First we studied the model, Euler-Bernoulli concept, assumption, right? How will be the strain and stress distribution? Then we spoke about what you mean by the value of H and mid plane. And we also told the discontinuity usually come across with respect to the free strain variation in the piezo element. So now that variation, what we get in the concept which was being derived by Euler-Bernoulli have to be now discussed. For that, you have the graph here which focuses on beam actuator free strain. Okay, so here the same thing. So that is associated with our mid-plane value. So this I told you already, H is the distance from the neutral axis to the top surface of the beam. So this distance is taken because it acts as a symmetrical value across the mid plane. So mid plane to the top surface of the beam. And the value of the mid plane is TS by 2. So this is also dealt. So now with respect to the mid plane, what is the mechanical load which has been resulting? So that you have to understand. So now here the strain, you can see you have the strain here, positive strain and the negative strain of the piezo element which is coming into picture. And this is the direction of the strain in which the material is getting deformed due to the applied load. So here you have to see that in free strain condition, what happens is the strain across the actuator will be equal to the strain across the substrate. In actual thing, here you can see the strain across a piezo element is not exactly equal to the strain across the substrate. But because this is not considering with respect to the free strain of the piezo element, we are just considering the actual strain distribution across the PZT patch and the structure. But when you focus on the free strain value, both will be equal. Due to this equality only, the variation will come and discontinuity occurs. And as a result, we are focusing upon the free strain concept. If you consider the free strain concept across the beam and the actuator, both will be having the same value. So the strain across the actuator will be equal to the strain across the piezo element. Even though this is true, the stress distribution across the actuator will be greater than the stress distribution across the substrate. So this is a true concept what you have to understand. If you won't consider the free strain, the matter is reverse. The strain will be the strain across the actuator will be almost equal to the strain across the substrate, but not totally equal. Slightly near to the value, but when you consider the free strain, it will be exactly equal. Even though it is equal, the stress across the actuator will be greater than the stress across the structure, which is similar to that of the graph what we have studied. Here also the stress is more in the piezo patch than that of the substrate at the top portion as well as the bottom portion. But when you consider the free strain, only the changes with respect to the strain. So that also you should understand. And with respect to the free strain, what happens is when the strain is equal across the patch of the piezo element and the structure, a superposition of the free strain comes into picture. that concept now you have to understand. So in case of superposition, so this superposition takes place across the bottom of the substrate and the top of the piezo element. If this is your top surface of the structure and above that you have the piezo patch, so there will be superposition of the values of the strain of the piezo element and this structure, because both the values are having equal free strain. In that case, we have to assume that the Young's modulus of the actuator is greater than that of the Young's modulus of the structure. So this assumption, we have taken it in the beginning when we explained related to the Bernoulli-Euler model, but now also with respect to superposition of the free strain, so this assumption will be holding good. Why we hold this assumption is the free strain in the PZT is independent of bending. Why? Because we are focusing all these related to the bending across the structure or the beam. But during this bending, due to the subjection of the mechanical loading, it is assumed that EA is greater than ES. Why? The free strain which is coming across the PZT will be independent of the bending. It won't focus about what is the bending which is coming across due to the applied loading. Because we are speaking about the free strain, it is not constrained with respect to any constraints. If it is constrained, then the value of strain will not be equal. You'll be having the variation. Since it has a free strain, the value of the PZT will be totally independent of bending. And second thing what you have to understand is it is always constant throughout the actuator thickness. Irrespective of what is the thickness of the actuator, the free strain always remains constant. So this is the diagram which shows the distribution of the stress producing the strain in the beam and the actuator. Okay, so here you can see you have the strain along the x direction, and this is the direction in which the polarization has taken place, and this is positive strain and this is negative strain, and this free strain will be always free of what all variation you have in the deformation. See, the strain value will be equal only the change in the sign convention, but here it can expand or contract depending upon the load which has been applied. But the value of the strain of the piezo element, whether it is expanded more or compressed more, remains the same. So that is what you have to understand. So the free strain in the piezo element will be same. So here you are seeing the changes in the deformation. It has been deformed here first and again it is coming back. So one is due to the expansion, another one is due to the compression. So the amount of expansion and amount of compression is different. It is not equally induced. Even though it has variation in compression and the tension value, the free strain will not alter. It will remain the same. That means to show that the free strain of the piezo element is not depending upon the bending, whether it is compression or the expansion. So this is the expansion of the substructure from here to here. Okay, so this is the upper part of the structure or the beam, and this is the lower part of the structure or the beam. Above that, you have the PZT patch here at the top and at the bottom. So where it is expanding and this direction coming back shows that it is again compressing. Depending upon the direction of the load, it gets expanded and it gets compressed. So you have the variation in the expanded length and you have the variation in the compressed length. Here also, both are not matching. Even though you have so much variation in bending with respect to compression and tension, the amount of free strain in the piezo element remains constant. So this is what you have to understand related to free strain and related to the superposition of it. After you understand that, you should see now, as the bending of the beam takes place with respect to the PZT actuators, the strain that produces stress in PZT is the superposition of the free strain and the bending strain. So what do you understand? So now we are speaking about the free strain. So now the bending of the beam has started. Why? Because the driving force is got from the PZT actuators, because the mechanical loading is subjected to PZT actuators. And as a result, bending of the beam come across the structure, which is driven by the PZT patch. Suppose you have, so this is our beam. So this is the entire beam, and you have the PZT at the top and the bottom. So this beam get expanded and compressed due to the loading which is subjected across the PZT patch. So this mechanical loading subjected into the PZT patch will behave like a driven force to make the structure to be bended, either due to compression or tension. Okay. So what happens is the superposition takes place. The strain that produces stress in the PZT is a superposition of the free strain and the bending. So when the mechanical loading is subjected to the PZT patch, strain is induced in the body. So that strain will produce the stress in the PZT patch. So the stress which has been produced in the PZT patch is superpositioned on the free strain of that particular PZT patch, because apart from the stress induced, the PZT will be having its own free strain. So that free strain will be overlapping with that of the stress which has been induced in the PZT patch due to the mechanical strain. And due to this superposition, the bending across the structure and the piezo element takes place. So when superposition comes into picture, so the free strain across the actuator will be always equal to the free strain across the structure minus the strain across the piezo elements. Okay, so how you define the strain across the actuator will be equal to the strain across the structure minus the strain across the piezo element, means to say this is the free strain of the piezo element without any constraints. It will be independent about the loading, so it is called as a free strain of a piezo element. So if they ask you what is the strain across the actuator, that will be always equal to the strain across the structure minus the strain across the piezo element, which is nothing but the free strain. And what does letter H refers here? So means it is a distance what you are measuring above the neutral axis. For that, you should go again back to the diagram here. So this is our H. So when you subject the mechanical loading to the actuator, what happens is the upper part totally will be under compression, and the lower part will be in the tension. Due to compression and tension, bending takes place. So due to bending, there will be obviously the strain and the stress induced in the material. So the strain across the actuator is nothing but the strain across the piezo element will be equal to the strain across the structure. Which part of the structure? It is only the H part, means half part of the structure above the neutral axis, minus the free strain value of this entire PZT patch. So that is what being given over here. So it is with respect to the value of H. We are focusing only the structure above the neutral axis, and hence you should not forget to write the letter H. If you won't write the letter H, then it shows that you are speaking with respect to the entire structure. Your free strain, the strain across the structure will show you the entire structure and not the half part of the structure above the neutral axis. And hence you should be very clear about the value of H. Right? So this is what you have to understand. So now you know, so this is the strain across the actuator and strain across the structure. And this comes to the strain. free strain of the piezo element. And this value of the piezo element will be always negative. Why? You are taking in the top of the actuator. The free strain usually will be positive and negative also. But here we are considering it as negative because you are focusing on the top part of the actuator. Again, the value of the free strain depends upon the sign polarity in which direction the voltage is being put forward as an electrode. So you'll be having a negative terminal here, again positive terminal here. And again, you'll be having negative terminal here and positive terminal here. Since at the top you have the negative terminal of the voltage, the free strain what you get will be negative. And hence the free strain will be negative across the top part of the PZT patch, which is nothing but our top actuator. So whenever you measure the free strain across the top of the PZT patch, you should not forget to write it as negative. If you write as positive, then it will be wrong. It shows that you are showing the free strain towards the bottom of the actuator, not the top, because the sign convention of the voltage polarity starts from negative to positive and again negative to positive. So at the bottom you get positive, and then the free strain at the bottom will be positive and the free strain at the top will be negative. That you have to remember. So the corresponding stress distribution in this case will be obtained by multiplying the strain in each material by appropriate elastic modulus. So once, until now we were speaking about the strain. So once strain is known across the actuator and across the structure and also the whole free strain, we should also be knowing to evaluate the stress distribution, right? So how you will develop the stress distribution? So that value of stress corresponding to each and every specific value of the strain means the strain across the actuator, the strain across the free strain, and the strain across the structure. So three strain you have: specific to actuator you have, specific to structure you have, and specific to free strain. So corresponding to these three strains, you should be having corresponding stress values also. So now you should think about how you calculate the corresponding stress. So how do you calculate it? So the corresponding stress distribution is obtained. How? You will multiply the strain in each material. So the strain you have, you know the value of strain across the actuator, you know the value of strain across the structure, and also the free strain. So those values you should multiply with the material by appropriate elastic modulus. So now the strain you have, if you multiply the value of strain across the actuator into the elastic modulus of the actuator, you will get the value of stress. The value of stress across the axial rod we have derived already. So which is stress across the actuator is equal to strain across the actuator into the elastic modulus. We have derived that equation already. Same concept we are applying here. Only thing is, there you used to get the transverse moment, and here compression and tension is coming into picture. But still we use the same concept to calculate the value of stress. So to calculate the value of stress, you should be knowing the value of elastic modulus. And here we are assuming the elastic modulus of the actuator will be greater than the elastic modulus of the structure. So the elastic modulus of the actuator again depends upon which type of piezo element you are using. Suppose you are using lead-based piezo element, the elastic modulus of EA will be comparatively higher than that of lead-free based piezo element. And also the elastic modulus of the structure, it depends upon which structure you are using. A structure is nothing but our substrate. The substrate can be made up of glass, it can be made up of mild steel, it can be made up of silicon, right? So silicon is a soft material. A mild steel is little bit and harder one. So depending upon the type of the structure or the substrate you use, even the elastic modulus of it will vary, right? So based on the material what you are selecting, corresponding Young's modulus, corresponding elastic modulus you will be having. So you will be just multiplying the values of elastic modulus of the actuator element and the elastic modulus of the substrate to the strain values what you have got over here. So that will help you to determine the stress which has been induced as shown in the figure. And so once you get the stress distribution, you can plot over here. Okay, similar to the strain, you can plot for the stress distribution and understand the variations. So this is how the PZT crystal exerts a distribution of moment on the beam. So now you have understood, what do you mean by Euler's Bernoulli model? What are the assumptions was followed, right? The two assumptions what they followed and how the Euler-Bernoulli model looks like. The significance of H and value of Ta. Then we also understood how the stress and strain distribution will be there without the concept of free strain. Then we took the concept of free strain and related the value of stress and strain and how the superposition comes into picture. In case of superposition, what is the assumption we use? Ea will be greater than Es. And also we told that the free strain will be always independent of any bending nature, and hence the value will not vary. So with that, we just showed the diagram of the free strain variations. And also due to the free strain, how the strain generated across the actuator and the shear stress varies also we studied, because free strain comes into picture where you have to subtract from the structural strain to get the strain across the actuator. And one thing I told you, you should not forget the value of H. So after that, we focused on, once you know the free strain, how you calculate the stress distribution. So for stress distribution, you have to multiply the strain value with the elastic modulus of the actuator as well as the substrate and get the corresponding values of stress. So if the stress and the strain are linearly varying, so these are the equations what we will be using it. Okay, this is only for linear variation. If stress is varying linearly with respect to strain, you can see the variation which is going linearly, right? So if the linear variation is there, so these are the two equations what you have to remember. No derivation, anything. These two equations you have to remember. If stress and strain is varying linearly, then the strain across the structure will be equal to the strain across the structure with respect to the H value. Means the strain value of the structure you are taking for the top part of the structure above the neutral axis into Z upon H. So this Z is nothing but the direction in which the material is polarized. So divided by the value of H. Value of H is the total height of the substrate. So this is a small h what I have told you. If we go to the diagram here, so this is the neutral axis, and the air height from the neutral axis to the top of the substrate is small h. So if you need the total h, it is the value of capital H. Okay, so this is how you have to understand. And hence the strain across the substrate will be equal to the strain across the substrate above the neutral axis into the value of Z, which is the direction of the polarity in which polarization has taken place, divided by the value of H. So this is about the strain. So once you know the strain, you should know the value of stress. So the value of stress across the substrate will be equal to the elastic modulus of the substrate into the strain across the substrate. So this is the equation what we follow. So once this general equation is done, you should now again split up with respect to the H value. So this will be simpler. In place of strain across the substrate, you will be substituting this value. So stress across the substrate equal to elastic modulus into the strain across the substrate. But strain across the substrate is equal to value here, what has been mentioned. So you'll substitute the same. So it becomes E suffix S, which is strain across the substrate, into the strain across the substrate above the neutral axis, multiplied by the direction in which the polarity is taken upon the total height of the structure. So this is how you evaluate the strain across the substrate. Similarly, you will determine the strain across the actuator. So strain across the actuator will be equal to the strain across the substrate above the neutral axis, multiplied by the direction in which the polarization is done, divided by the total value of H minus the free strain. Well, so when you calculate the stress, the free strain comes into picture because we have derived this equation already. So the strain across the actuator is equal to strain across the substrate minus the strain across minus the free strain. So based on this equation, you are now changing it with respect to the implementation of the polarization axis and the total value of the substrate. Okay, so and as a result, your EA value changes in this way. So after you have calculated the EA value, then you should find out the value of the stress. This is a strain across the actuator. So what will be the strain across the, what will be the stress across the actuator? I told you the stress is obtained by multiplying the elastis modulus of the actuator into the strain across the actuator. So elastis modulus of the actuator you will be knowing depending upon which piezo element you are using. So that value will be substituted here. And the strain across the actuator you have calculated here already based on the previous equation which has been mentioned. So as per that, you will substitute the value of free strain across the actuator and you will get this equation. So now it is 9:30. And further, we have some small variations with respect to yielding of H value. I'm sorry. So that I'll be doing it in the next class at 11:50. It is a very important question, frequently asked question, elaborative derivation part. What you have to explain, understand thoroughly. We have now derived half portion of Euler's beam model. So remaining half portion we will be dealing it in the next class. So now if you have any doubts, you please kindly let me know. You have to understand properly. Is it clear, everyone?
Yes, ma'am.
Any yes, doubts?
Ma'am. No, ma'am.
Okay. And
no, ma'am.
Yeah. What about your place, this one, industrial training, is it over or again you need to go? Or it is planned to the weekend? Because last time we missed two classes on Monday.
Ma'am, we have applied, ma'am, but we are waiting for their confirmation, ma'am.
Okay, you just put them a request. You'll be doing it either on Friday or Saturday.
So that will be
okay.
Better so that we won't miss the class. So I just wanted to inform that. So please attend the class, 11:50 class, because we will be continuing this Euler-Bernoulli model and we have to end up with that theoretical derivation. Okay. Yeah. So until then, now you please take care. And the quiz, what I have to give, I'll give it together after completion of the 11:50 to 12:50 class. So you'll be attending two quiz of 10 marks. Okay. Sure then. Until then, please take care. Have a nice day. Good day. And I hope all have written your name and USN number. No one has written. Kindly type your name and USN in the chat room. Three people have written, remaining four, two more. Mohan Ambal present?
Yes, ma'am.
Sukrut?
Yes, ma'am.
Mithun?
Yes, ma'am.
Mithun, why you were absent in the previous classes?
Ma'am, I went to HL, ma'am, for asking internship.
Okay. Are the things clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Sandesh?
Yes, ma'am.
Sriharsha? Sriharsha, you're there?
Yeah, ma'am.
Okay, attend the classes regularly, even you are not regular.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. So, meet again at 11:50. Until then, take care and bye-bye. Have a good day. Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye-bye.